So you're telling me I get my own LFR?
Yes, you do.
The whole thing.
The whole thing.
And I get to do that today.
Oh, no, we're not doing that today.
Why not?
This is season 15. Your last one was season 6. You can wait a little longer, all right?
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits!
Left Toronto Maple Leafs.
Let me finish.
How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?
I'm quite hyped. With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Puppy Ziggy, do you remember worrying about Austin Matthews for 1 second and how silly that was? You don't?
Leafs win 2-1 in overtime over the Calgary Flames in what I thought was a pretty good game. Very different pace to this game from the last one that we talked about with the Philadelphia Flyers, where I was fixated on, are the Flyers bad? In this one, what I noticed about the two teams is, oh, the Calgary Flames are good, and oh, the Leafs look good too. Before we talk about that, I have to talk to you about the Eric Lindros Celebrity Hockey Classic that I was at today. Oof, this stinks. Rachel's Raiders, which was my team that took to the ice at the Eric Lindros Celebrity Hockey Classic. It's a team that is named after my sister, Rachel, who is an Easter Seals kid. Easter Seals is a charity that helps out kids with physical disabilities, and my sister has cerebral palsy. But you know all that because I've told you 1,000 times. Today, we got to play in the tournament, and this stays in the house. Yes, I've seen your comments. It looks like, I almost look like Adam, don't I? Rachel's Raiders were the top fundraising team at the 2021 Eric Lindros Celebrity Hockey Classic, raising $70,000. I've told you before, I'll say it again, I don't know how to communicate to you what a life-changing amount of money that can be for people. Wheelchairs, motorized wheelchairs, AFOs, camp experiences, so much more. And you guys are always there, year in and year out. We don't know the exact number, but over the last 3 years or so, Rachel's Raiders has raised something in the neighborhood of $250,000. But that's you. That's you. Again, today was chaos. I'm still catching up with it all, but hundreds and hundreds of you donated. I think it's the most individual donors we've had. If not, it's the second most, something like 700 or 800 different people. With the first overall pick in the draft, we selected Wendell Clark. He was our alumni and we got to hang out with him all day and he played with us and he told us stories and oh, it was so good. I might tell you a little bit of what we talked about on the podcast. That's for another day. It's called a tease, kids. I learned from Adam. I was the coach for some of the games, mostly because I aggravated my back. Did you know that I complain about my back sometimes? But I did get to play in a game as well. And strangely, that was the only one we lost. Isn't that weird? It's weird. It's so weird. It was awesome. It was a great experience. And the best part of it all is we got to help kids and you did that. So thank you. All right. You want to talk about the Leafs and Flames? Getting back to it, I want to start with this question that I got. Is it just me or did this feel like playoff hockey? And it's funny you should ask that because I wondered the exact same thing to myself in the first period. And then I wondered it to myself in the second period as well, but for a different reason. First period was incredibly high paced. It was really fun. It was kind of like the Bruins game from a few days ago, how I really liked the jump that both teams had. They were exchanging chances, the Flames get a 2-on-1, Andre Kasha flying in there. How good has he looked over the past few games? My goodness. David Kampf getting rocked a couple times, most notably by Matthew Tkachuk. It's Zadorov and Wayne Simmons going at it. Richie and Gudbranson were exchanging information or something. So it felt like a playoff game just because of the toughness. It was a game that had a little snarl. The second period felt like a playoff game for completely different reasons. Both teams seemed to be playing hard, fast, but disciplined hockey. Like in years past, that's not a November regular season game that we get out of the Leafs all the time. Yeah, the Flames are on the second half of a back-to-back, so maybe you grade on a little bit of a curve, but both teams were pretty decent at limiting the other team's scoring chances. Or at very least, limiting their mistakes, because teams were creating scoring chances. And from the Leafs' perspective, obviously I'm just filling to get to the third period where all the goals happen, but from the Leafs' perspective, the power play, which has actually been pretty good over the last few games, got a few opportunities in this one, had 3 penalties in the first half of the game, and wasn't able to convert. But this was a rare instance where I actually thought the power play, despite not scoring, looked really good. They were definitely getting their chances, but the Flames, top 10 on both special teams, were even better. And how about Dan Vladar in net? Dude, I saw the Flames sign this guy, and I was like, I don't know what they're thinking. Like, I suppose Markstrom is just going to play every game then? And I'm not trying to hate on the guy, it's just he's the Flames' second goalie, and he's played 8 NHL games, and 3 of them were this season. Actually, I don't know, did HockeyDB update after this game? It might have been 9. He's had good AHL numbers over the past couple seasons, and he's only 24, but still, it's a bit of a leap of faith to say, all right, you're an NHL goalie. Like, the goalie that we pay a lot of money? Yeah, the second he gets hurt, you're our starting goalie. But shoot, he was solid in this one. But Jack Campbell, speaking of goalies who turned out to be pretty good despite not having the longest track record of NHL success, was also very good. What else? I thought Marner had a lot of pop, and Tavares and Matthews and Nylander. It's not just that the core four have started to put up points, and in a big way. They seem to be playing faster and more determined and tougher and with more focus and desire. Yes, it's easy to look and go, oh, they have X amount of points in X amount of games, but what I'm seeing is a different group right now. What they need right now is support, and there are going to be nights where they're not going, and that's why it's so encouraging to see Kasha doing what he's doing. So we go to the third period, and never tweet. I tweeted, this is pretty fun as 0-0 games go. Once again, never tweet. The Flames scored about 40 seconds after I posted that. And naturally, the comments roasted me because I deserved it. You ever know better, but you don't? It's me. And the goal that the Flames scored, which was a really nice goal. It was sort of a broken 2-on-1, and it was a mess in general. Just kind of a chain of bad decisions that start in the offensive zone. Riley pinches, which is fine. He shoots it, and then after the shot, he goes all the way around. So if the Flames turn it the other way now, he's not going to be back there, so you're going to need people in support. Maybe it was because Marner was flying back so fast, but Kerfoot decides to go for the loose puck, and he doesn't win the battle. Now, Marner's got wheels. Like, he's keeping up with Shillington, and it's difficult because I think the camera angle can be a liar in these situations, but I thought Marner was keeping up with him. But he makes a decision to cut to the other side, probably because he's on the wrong side of Oliver Shillington if he wants to prevent him from getting the pass. Him and Brody don't seem to communicate that, and Brody commits to Gaudreau as Marner commits to Gaudreau, which means nobody has Shillington, which means Silky Mitts Gaudreau, all he has to do is get a pass through to Shillington, which he does. Nice move on Jack Campbell, and of course, the Flames score right after I tweet it, right after. We're talking about whose fault that goal was. Mine the most. I'm sorry. So it's 1-0 Flames, and all we can hope is that it does not end like that. And it doesn't, because William Nylander did a thing in a game where the Calgary Flames were winning 1-0 in the third period. This feels like it happened weirdly recently. Like, before the pandemic, I want to say Riddick was in net, but for the Flames? Nylander and Kasha trying to apply some chaos, some pressure to the Calgary Flames, and they might have applied just enough that they made mistakes. Vladar goes for a poke check. He kind of puts it in Shillington's stick, but not in a helpful way. He kind of has to panic a bit. That's why he had the most brutal clearing attempt ever. It lands right on Alexander Kerfoot's stick. He throws it over to William Nylander for the one-timer again. Scores! They ended up giving it to Andre Kasha. There he is again with the tip in front, and the Leafs tie the game. And you know what? I kind of had a feeling that Kasha tipped it the whole time because his reaction was way too jacked. Like, I know he just tied the game in the third period, but there was something about it. Like, I know he's happy that we scored, but that face says I scored, you know? That goal comes with about 7 minutes to go, and let's be honest, by the time the final minute came, both teams looked at each other in the standings and said, you're East, we're West, who cares? Let's just get the point. They did, and then it's overtime. In overtime, Jack Campbell had to make a spectacular save, as you're always going to have to do. 3-on-3 overtime, it shortens all of our lives. But at the other end, Austin Matthews sprung on a breakaway. Dan Vladar cannot like that. And nothing. Because he tries to go 5-hole, it almost works, but it doesn't go in, and that's very strange, because I'm not used to Austin Matthews missing those. Sharp eye from Ray Ferraro on the broadcast, because he shows on the monitor Austin Matthews going back to the bench, and he says, my stick's broken. Well, very next shift, it wasn't broken. I'm going to be a slight buzzkill. 3-on-3 wins should maybe not count towards, well, it should count in the standings, but it shouldn't count towards your playoff expectations, you know what I mean? On account of it. it's 3-on-3 and not 5-on-5, and that's not the same thing at all? Because it becomes a few things. Number one, a line change contest, which is how the Leafs gave up that 2-on-1 in the first place. It's also how Mitch Marner got on the ice and gave the Leafs two chances in like 10 seconds, including a one-timer of his own. But also the lightning-quick decisions and the little miscalculations. They burn you every time. And I loved this goal because the Leafs did exactly the opposite of what I thought they were going to do. And I've talked about this on the podcast before. They look way too predictable. Way too often I'm able to watch the Leafs and go, I know what they're about to do. Which is bad because I'm not smart and the other teams are, and they're going to figure it out. So here we are, 2-on-2. Auston Matthews with the puck. He crosses the blue line. Now what the Leafs do so often here in 3-on-3 is the drop. The difference is often with this drop, it's another guy carrying the puck and they drop it for Auston. Auston ain't dropping it. Gaudreau does a good job of switching and following Riley. I thought that was the right play, obviously, but Rasmus Anderson, it's almost like he doesn't fully commit to Matthews. Like, I'm sorry, he can score from there. That's too much space. Like I said, this stick wasn't broken, rips it, 5-hole, exactly where he meant to put it before, and Auston Matthews wins it in overtime. 2 points. Jack Campbell, stellar again. Mitch Marner, really solid in this game. I thought it was a really good game from both teams. An exciting game as far as 0-0 games go. There's nothing wrong with both goalies putting on a show. Questions? I know Matthews scored an OT, but is he still healing his wrist? Doesn't look the same. Hasn't been taking shots like he normally does. Something is off, no? There's maybe something there. I mean, after this amount of time, I'd be surprised if he was 100%. I mean, he might be 90, which is still really good. It's just not 100. I don't think it's that Auston Matthews isn't taking shots he normally takes. I think he is taking shots he normally takes. It's just they're not all going in. I think it's less to do with pain or discomfort and more to do with just timing. Just timing. It's really early in the season. He's still doing well. And the standard for Matthews is beyond ridiculous. I think he's fine. If Jack was a soup, what kind of soup would he be? Chicken noodle soup, because he just makes you feel better, except he'd be the reduced sodium kind, because I can never imagine Jack being salty. Wool is starting tomorrow. Any thoughts? Yeah. Good luck, Joseph. So, I've talked about this. Joseph Woll, first of all, this is the friendliest goaltending tandem in the entire league. Jack Campbell and Joseph Woll, you're gonna really like this guy. The first time I met him a few years ago, he reminded me exactly of James Reimer in terms of just the way he carried himself. Now, really promising coming out of NCAA. He's had a tough start to his pro career in mostly the AHL. And I blame a lot of that on the Marlies being garbage and also COVID. Like, that's a guy who, with the goaltending depth, could have used the starting job maybe with the Newfoundland Growlers, but there were no Newfoundland Growlers last season. I saw a lot of people panicking, and you're totally looking at it the wrong way. It's the second half of a back-to-back. Yes, it is Hockey Night in Canada, but it's second half of a back-to-back. The Sabres have also played, and they're going to be on the second half of a back-to-back, even though they're going to be the home team. But more importantly than all of that, we're barely into mid-November, and Jack Campbell has already played too many games. He should never have to play both halves of a back-to-back. Maybe, if it's the very end of the season and the Leafs are fighting for their playoff lives, but they're just not right now. They're actually doing pretty well. They just won this one against Calgary. Maybe it would have been different if they lost, but they didn't lose, so Woll is gone. It's not out of the question that he could be just fine. Who knows? Zach Vukalli got a shutout this week. Did any of you call that? Leafs Nation, get behind the kid. Get behind Joseph Woll. Believe in him. But big win. It's been a long day, so I'm gonna pack it up. That is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Thank you.